old people, and as she will tell you in a short while, we are a very, very young country. We are probably the youngest world, probably. We are the youngest country of the world, in all likelihood. However, we still have a huge, huge number of old people, and we do not have a good social security system. Our parliamentarians have gone telling the world that, you know, we have the largest public social security system. However, the amount of funds available there is grossly inadequate. So therefore, concern and taking care of elders is a very big area. The other one is Dr. Pratim Rai. He's here. As you can see, he's working so hard, he's got sunburn. Again, Dr. Pratim Rai is a long-term friend. I mean, 2 decades probably now.
I'm a student.
Yeah, it's all right, but you know, I mean, it's 18 years. And he comes from this particular organization, which has been recognized as a pioneering organization with a huge number of awards for, you know, as a, is an Asia best case study. So they are, in what they do, they've been recognized as the best in Asia. So Pratim puts that forward. Okay? Another thing for Anuradha. Anuradha usually comes with a PowerPoint, but this time she wants to make it interactive. So may I request all of you, before she says it, take your name cards out. And if I may tell you,
talk. Is there,
but no, no. But what I'm saying is, you see the name cards, so you're free to talk to them because you know who they are. At least you know their names. Okay, over to Anuradha.
Would you prefer the label?
Thank you, Mr. Maker. India is a young country, you said? Yes, but a very old civilization. As you know, it's 5,000 years and more. But when we say a young country, we always draw the line that since we got independence from the colonial rule of the British, and if we count that, that was in 1947, in that respect, we are a young country. And the problem actually starts with that, because our heritage, our culture, and our way of life that was before we were colonized was totally different. Respect for elders, living, it was an agricultural society, so people stayed together, families were not that. And because it was agricultural, people and families stayed together, and of course, not only the neighbor, but the entire village and small town, they exactly knew who the neighbors were, who the people were in the nearby villages and towns, and if there was any problem, whether health issues, any emergency in the night, it was the people who were there that came to everybody's help. But anyway, all that changed because there was an onslaught of invasion on India and its culture and civilization. Whether it was the Mughals or, you know, the from Middle East, from Mongolia, and then of course the British who came here to trade, and then they stayed on and colonized. So all the problems, in fact, the social problem, the economic problem, started from there. So this is the introduction, because as Mr. Mitter said, that this is a young country, I just wanted to clarify that point. So of course it came with its own good and its own bad, and the bad thing was that as, you know, with industrialization and now with globalization, people are staying not with families, but are dispersed all over the world. And that is why the problem, whether it is in the villages, in big cities, and wherever. But since we were not used to having a social structure in the sense that, you know, welfare, in the welfare system by the government, so we were not really ready to cope with it. Next, not ready to go to old age homes, because nobody liked going to old age homes. Even now, There's so many old age homes coming up, pay and stay homes, free homes. But you know, it is always a trauma for that person to go and stay in old age home, which is not there. This is a transition period which is going on in our society. And because now everything is global, it's a global society, these changes are bound to come. So how are we going to deal with these problems as a country with our legislations and rules, etc., etc.? This NGO, Helpage India, where I work, is 40 years old now, which is quite something for an NGO to stay and establish itself in this country. I am here working for the last 32 years. So just imagine the society 32 years back when, you know, our family members, cousins, all very interested in what one is doing. So when I told them that, yes, I joined an NGO, and nobody knew the word NGO actually, what it actually meant. Because here in India, people goes for professions like engineering, they're doctors and lawyers. Apart from that, nobody really knew anything more than that. And if you're not a doctor or a lawyer or an engineer, which means actually you don't have any brains. So that was the idea. So when I said I've joined an NGO, so they asked that, you know, what is it about? So I said, this NGO takes care of the older people. And they used to really, you know, laugh and say, oh my God, older people don't take care? They have the best of time now. They are retired you know, they are at home. People are there looking after them. So what is their problem? You take care of them. So I said yes. And I was also thinking, I also agree to that fact. And what is it that I'm doing? Firstly, Helpage was a fundraising organization and we were raising funds. But for those older people who are actually poor. So now next I went back to them and I said, well, actually we are working for the poor, for the poor older people. Now, as I said, that was 32 years back. Now, after 32 years, nobody laugh or tell me, oh, you know, what does this NGO do? Because everybody knows an old age is a problem where, you know, the whole society is now trying to deal with. And not only, and there are many types of problem, and as our organization's tagline says, Helpage India fighting isolation in old age, poverty, which is a different genre of problem, and neglect. So these are the three things we are fighting. So it is not only for the poor people in the villages, but also in big towns and cities, people are facing isolation, neglect. Along with that, abuse. Abuse mainly for financial economic reasons. People, you know, take the property and then they don't, they're turned out of their house, then, you know, the legal proceedings and all those things go on. So the thing is, how entrepreneurship with NGOs, that is the subject. What do you do with senior citizens, old people, people who are poor? As an NGO, we do not do any entrepreneurship, but we help the poor people, mainly in villages, to set up something which we call livelihood, and that is their entrepreneurship. And I can tell you it is very difficult because they do not have a common livelihood. In very rare cases they do. You must have all heard about tsunami. And in tsunami what happened, the southern coastal area of India, it got affected. And the livelihood we did with them was of fish net, weaving nets, you know, getting back to the same profession of going out to the high sea and fishing and selling those fish in the market. So everybody who was affected by tsunami had a common livelihood. So our work was much easier over there. But entrepreneurship with NGOs, how easy could it be in a village where people are already old physically? They can't do much as they used to do when they were young. And the socio-economic status, you must know, is always very important. Their nutrition, their way of life when they were younger, and now at old age, how much they can do. So generally, when we are talking about entrepreneurship with NGO, it is not what they are making, what they are doing. It is the older people, what they can do. So mainly it is forming group. And we called it the Elder Self-Help Group. Now, these groups are entitled to loans from the bank. But till such time, like there are social, self-help groups, but they're mainly of women, and there is a circular. So if there is no common livelihood, what can they do? So we formed them, and bank loan. Sorry, I was talking about bank loan. So there is a circular by the Indian government. It is the Reserve Bank of India who gets the permission to give loan. And you can give loan to self-help group, because actually you have to, the bank always has to get back the loan. So they don't really want to give loan where they can see that there is very minimal return. And with elder self-help group, that was not a possibility at all till such time. But our work and a sustainable income with the elder self-help group has now, this is a matter of information that I'm giving you, the RBI has sent a circular that they will give loan, the banks will give loan, cash credit loan to these elder self-help group, and also along with it they added another disadvantaged and vulnerable group in the sense when they are handicapped. Now, I have a film over here which I'll show you what generally the entrepreneurship means and what the older people can do in old age.
Please.
So about Helpage, it's first started, as I said, giving the history, as a welfare organization, because the belief was that older people cannot work, cannot do any livelihood, any entrepreneurship cannot be done by older people. Then we changed all that, we went into development activity, which means livelihood and entrepreneurship with the older people, and then on to advocacy. Advocacy is policy advocacy, which is necessary with the government, so that government brings out policies to mainstream the older people. Now, the film, this cannot be any bigger, but I hope you can have an idea. After you see the film, I'll get back to you, because it is very difficult for you to understand that what goes on in villages, the life they lead, and what entrepreneurship can be done by them.
Start
at
the beginning.
Yes, just 22 seconds. Just
this. Purubia is a district located in West Bengal, is rich with culture and natural beauty. Helpage India supports the villagers by focusing on their problem of elder self-help group. We, with the support of Helpage, covered some of the villages and gained lots of experience. We mainly focused on Moruma and many other villages. People here have their group meetings once in a week and started with a prayer song, and here they keep records of the interlining of Mahila.
because otherwise they do not know each other, they are not aware of their rights. And what do these groups do? Not only interlending, not only taking loans from the bank, but they are also aware of their rights, they are made aware of their rights and entitlement. So that whatever government welfare schemes are there, they know how to access that. Because to the, absolutely to the grassroots level, we have the panchayat system where they can go and they, where they can make their demands, enlist their names for social security. Now, as a group, they have the certain rules and regulations which are there and which goes on in the group. Like they, you've seen them meet with a prayer song. And the kind of activity they can do, it is not very hard physical activity. But you've seen that animal husbandry, you saw a goat. So, you know, if a goat is given to them, they don't have the money. So what NGOs do, they give them things with which they can earn. So if they have a goat, you know, goat's milk, and then they rear that goat, and then, from there, they lend out that goat. So that is how they make their income. The other sources of income are, in the villages, when there is a marriage, they need chairs and tables and cooking utensils. So if the groups are given that, they can do business with those things by lending it to those people who may require it. Then making mustard oil from mustard seeds. So there's a machine also there. Those machines are expensive machines. So what Helpage does is they give the machines to these groups. And the groups, their activity, their livelihood is by lending that machine or making mustard oil from that machine, and then they make their livelihood like that. You have noticed in one of the places that they're putting fistful of rice into a place. Okay, so in a tin container or something like that. Those are for the people. It is initially the concept was that if you are old, then you are unable to do anything. You cannot do any activity. There's no livelihood. And I'm talking about actually the economically vulnerable sector. The poor people in the villages. What happens in the cities is when people retire from active life, they have been generally into some kind of a profession, so they know what to do. For them, entrepreneurship, starting something new is not a problem. It is only for those people in the villages that they really do not know how to earn a living after a certain age. So what Helpage does is for those older people in the villages, they give the initial expenses, the capital asset with which they can earn some or do some livelihood out of that. And to do that, it is not given to an individual. What we emphasize, what you've seen here, is that we form them into groups. So it is called they're organized into groups. And then they can, together. Because if anybody takes a loan, they can take a loan from the group itself. Because there's a system of saving, every week they meet and everybody puts in 10 rupees or 20 rupees, and then that money is put in the bank in the name of the group, and then the bank also gives cash credit loan to them. And it is the group puts the pressure on the individual person who takes the loan to repay the loan and in time. So the interest rate of the loan is very small, and the reason is that this is kind of a welfare thing that the government of India is doing for those vulnerable groups under the name of the elder self-help group. And the other thing that we've noticed is that I think I've covered it all. So the one thing I would just like to point it out over here, that the elderly are now not divided according to age. Technically, if you are 60, then you are a senior citizen. But we have divided them into the active agent, the assisted agent, and the destitute agent. So the active agent are the one, they can be 70 years and still be active. At the age of 65, somebody may be a destitute agent, totally immobilized because of some sickness. So the fistful of rice is actually, since they are getting money and they're getting things for them to start a business and earn something, there is a condition laid that those people in the community, in that same village who are absolutely vulnerable, bedridden, immobile, destitute, has no family members due to migration and many other reasons, then they have to take care of that elderly in the community and in the village. And so that's how it works. So, in fact, I've finished my presentation over here. If you have any questions, any understanding, you know, anything you want to understand, want to question me, you can do it right now.
Is there anything you do for elderly people with like certain, let's say, situations like Alzheimer's and similar like that?
Yes. Actually, Helpage as an NGO, we give support to organization who has that professional skill and any age-related problem and support them. So we don't do it directly as such, but we help those institutions, like there's an Alzheimer's Society, and we give all the, you know, funding support to these groups. But as you said, that in the villages, the awareness level is very low regarding Alzheimer's, and people think that, you know, he's just out of his mind, he's lost his mind, he's gone mad, and you know, there's a taboo attached to it. So what we do is we try to create an awareness with those group, as I said, elder self-help group. It is not only interlending and, you know, livelihood, these are the other factors that are included in that also.
Do the families of the elderly still support them, or are they completely?
Yes, that's a good question. The families, you see, in the villages, the group I'm talking about, as long as they're earning, you know, they are not from an organized sector, which means that they don't have any bank savings as such, no provident fund, okay, to take care of them, no pension funds to take care of them when they retire, or when they cannot work anymore in this case. So most of the families, they do not treat their elderly well because it's a question of economic problem. So with this forming them into groups, and you know, when they start earning money, livelihood, sometimes they are given cash credit, which they give it to their sons or family members so that they can, you know, do some business and repay the loan, and the entire family gets benefited. So when in a group, when we form this elderly self-help group and livelihood group, they get back their dignity and respect from their family members. Anything? Anybody want to give your input that in a business situation which you saw in that video, what best can be done with them? How they can market their, you know, whatever skill they have, how to best sort of, because in the marketplace, you know, there's the outgoing and the incoming market flow. So how can they best show their product, sell their product, and earn a better livelihood within the given situation and condition? We also have an old age home in Kolkata, our own. It's a model home, and there are 10 residents staying there. And it is actually an aged care center where there's a physiotherapy center, there's a stationary medical unit, and there's an elder helpline also, and we work very closely with the police. And what we have done in this home is, it's a model home because it can be replicated and scaled up by any other home, is that they're always involved in something. Previously, in old age homes, you think that, you know, they're here to relax, watch TV, read newspapers, eat, sleep, and that's it. But that did not have a very good effect on the psychologically or even physically. So what we do is, you know, we involve them in most of our programs, and you know, that way they are much better. They think that, you know, they are still contributing and they still have value. So that is what we do in our home. It's a free home, of course, and all these components that I spoke about are actually carried out there. UN, there are five things regarding elderly issues. I should let you know that. One is independence. Okay? Because you are old, it does not mean that you will be emotionally and physically and dependent on everybody. So one is independence. One is self-fulfillment. You should do whatever you want to do. One is participation. Because we think that the elderly, and that is where the intergenerational gap comes in. You know, we think that the elderly are not useful anymore. We have a digital literacy for the elderly because of this same reason. And self-fulfillment, care and dignity. The most important is the dignity part. Right to life, you know, is one of our fundamental rights. Everybody has a right to life. In case of the elderly, the Supreme Court of India has passed a judgment in the year 2008. Right to life with dignity. And this dignity factor actually involves the senior citizen. What they need most is your empathy, compassion, and a little bit of self-respect, especially from the younger generation. Okay.
Thank you. There's a question there.
Yeah.
I forgot another question. How do people get paid for these homes? Do you go to the villages and then look for them and like ask them if they want to come with you? Or how exactly does it work?
As an NGO, I am a paid employee of Helpage India. And if I have understood your question, you are talking about the funds, isn't it?
No, like how does it work operationally? Do you go into like...
Yes, what we do, we address them. They don't know us. And we have to go and stay in the villages. It's called village immersion. And try and find people in the villages who are more educated and literate than most. And younger people, we bring them to our payroll. And we call them village animators. So they know their villages. And we enter the village through them. And then we address the issues. Then slowly, you know, go to